Oh man, my mom always told me I could grow up to be anything.
If you thought this was just another picture of the moon, then you'd actually be wrong. Hi, I'm Nolan, a team member at Active Galactic Videos, and we came to Flagstaff, Arizona to find out more about a crazy story in our space travel history. We want to know why NASA blew holes in the desert to make a map of the moon.
I'm Kevin Schindler, historian at Lowell Observatory.
I'm Lazslo, a geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey.
Awesome.
Where are we right now? What is this? What are we sitting in?
You're in a crater, an artificial one.
We're about a half an hour drive from Flagstaff, downtown Flagstaff, and Sunset Crater is, I don't know, a mile or so, a couple miles north of us. And it was built 51 years ago this year, specifically to help train the astronauts in preparation for going to the moon. So they got images from the moon, a specific area of the Sea of Tranquility, and painstakingly created this.
So all these craters were actually built, hand-built?
The craters were built, wouldn't say by hand. They used a lot of explosives. They tried to reproduce as close as possible the surface of the moon so that the astronauts would have a good feeling for what it's like to work there. They did a lot of calculations to know how much explosive you need to put in the ground to make different size holes, and then buried craters in all the right locations to mimic the way the craters are distributed on the moon, and then set them off in an order that mimics the ages of the craters on the moon so that the material that's blown out of each crater would land on top of each other in the right pattern.
That sounds crazy. That sounds ridiculous that, you know, scientists are like, you know, we should just blow up the ground. Like, why? Why did they do this?
So there's no place on Earth that has small impact craters. And that's because we have a good thick atmosphere that stops the smaller ones. And also the surface is very geologically active, so it erases small craters quickly. And so the only way to get a surface that really looked like the moon is to create it artificially.
You know, there are a couple differences because the way the craters are formed on the moon is an impact, something hitting it from space and then splashing out. And these were created by burying explosives and blowing out. But it still had enough of the same effect. The craters still look the same.
What was the main advantage, you think, of having this life-size atlas of the moon?
So there's a lot of little practical details that you learn by actually trying to work in the field as opposed to just thinking about it. Having live TV was originally considered to be difficult, risky, not worth the effort because it's new technology, potentially would fail and be embarrassing and so forth. So they started doing the tests out here without live TV. And it turned out you couldn't keep track of what the astronauts were doing just by talking. That radio communication just wasn't giving enough awareness for the people back in the simulated Houston to keep track of what's going on. And it became a safety issue. And so they decided it was absolutely essential to have live TV. It also allowed us to see the first steps on the moon live. It also enabled the science team on Earth to talk to the scientists and to the astronauts and understand what they're doing and interact with them much more efficiently. It enabled all kinds of other things. It wouldn't have been clear how necessary that was if they didn't do these kinds of tests.
You can get your phone and look at the satellite imaging, and you can see these craters. And if you did an aerial view and then compare the aerial view to the same area on the moon, it's still going to look fairly similar, except there's trees and bushes growing in here. That's going to be a big difference.
Wow.
And that's something that several of the astronauts have commented on. They said coming to northern Arizona is when they really got it with geology. Because sitting in the classroom looking at rocks or pictures is one thing, but being able to stand in the middle of a landscape and understand how it was formed by looking at it made a big difference for them. And that's when they really understood the value of learning geology.
I mean, one of the things that's really striking is how different the Earth is from the moon. I mean, all these plants have popped up so fast. There are things that still really hit you so much better walking around on foot and seeing with your own eyes than looking at a computer simulation, because now we can make amazing simulations of what it's like on the surface of the moon. But that whole effect of when you're slightly elevated or looking at an image from above, you can see all these craters. You can see how they're oriented with respect to each other, and you can figure out where you are so easily. But if you're standing, you're suddenly lost. Oh, you see a crater in front of you, you can't figure out which crater that is. That there's a visceral understanding of what you're dealing with going to an alien planet that you don't get unless you come in person and see something like this.
Who knew blowing 47 craters in the middle of northern Flagstaff was going to help us get to the moon?
I don't know, it's just such an amazing experience to be out walking in these craters and being able to be so close to, you know, a landmark that helped us get to the moon.
Wow.
Do you guys care to get a picture just right in front of this guy?
Sure.
Awesome. Hope you enjoyed our video at the Cinder Lake Crater Field. Special shout out to Lazslo Kestay and Kevin Schindler for helping us out. As always, I'm Nolan, and thanks for watching.